to continue the meeting, which was begun in the smaller room. And the plan here is to continue with the next item, which is in fact the item regarding bees here. And we believe that the audience will probably thin down after that. And so after this, our intent is to go into the back to the other room and continue with the rest of the meeting. So at this point, I think the item is regarding the UDC as it relates to animal husbandry. Tom?
Well, yeah, I can start off and provide some of the background. We have the agenda item. We added as item 9, possible UDC animal control ordinance modification to clarify the definition of livestock and or domesticated animals. This was originally on a work session agenda earlier this year. It was postponed. The background information I can provide to you is grounded. It's based in our unified development code, our zoning ordinance. Our zoning ordinance prohibits livestock in most residential zoning districts. The ordinance also has a definition of livestock, which I reviewed in detail with our legal staff, and our findings were that the way that definition is worded, it includes honeybees that are raised honeybees. That sparked some debate, some dialogue, or is that really the intent of our ordinance, and is it what we want to accomplish through our zoning ordinance? And I believe the item being placed on today's agenda was developed out of that, a discussion of, do we want to modify the zoning ordinance to address this issue? That's the real short summary of it. And at that point, I think I'm ready to listen for any direction from the board. And my aim is all to be looking for some direction from the board of commissioners if they want me to work with the legal staff on modifying our zoning ordinance to allow honeybees in residential zoning districts other than what is today. And today it is limited to R1R and R1 as far as residential zoning districts where it is permitted. It is permitted in A1, which is our agricultural zoning district, and it is a conditional use permit in Res 1. But as pointed out to me in a meeting last week with the Forsyth County Beekeepers, there are some provisions in Res 1 that make it unfeasible as currently written, and that is specifically a restriction that places a limitation of one animal per acre, which obviously would not work for this use.
Thank you, Tom. And I would just like to take this opportunity quickly to say that certain times, from time to time, certain ones of us or all of us are put in an odd position of having to make an interpretation about something. Tom did that to the best of his ability. It's not necessarily something we all agree with, but that is what happens in this in government sometimes. And I think we need to, at a minimum, respect the position that some of us get put in and the decision that they tried to make for the best of the county at the time they made it. So, thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I think the big people have a short video. I could make a motion to save us all a lot of time, I believe.
Well, then you should watch the video.
You want to watch the video?
Yes, okay. We'll show us the video.
Good.
Do you have such?
Is there a video?
There is video, and yeah, it's on the screen. I would like to thank the commissioners for inviting us.
I'm sorry, Lori.
My name is Mark Conlon. I'm representing the Forsyth Beekeepers Club in this county. So once again, I appreciate you inviting us here to talk about honeybees. Our presentation is going to cover four things.
Sir, could I ask you to speak into the microphone, please? Thank you.
Our presentation is going to cover four things. First of all, we're going to do our very best to educate you about what a honeybee is, about the importance of the honeybee. Second, we're going to try to show you the very docile nature of the bee. Third, we're going to show that there is kind of a movement within the world, the country, and the state toward the encouragement rather than discouragement of all natural things, including the honeybee. And last, we're going to talk about our understanding of the UDC for local communities and municipalities. So the honeybee, can you all see the screens?
Yes.
Okay. The honeybee is the only insect that provides food that we can eat, and that food, of course, is honey. But the honeybees do something even more important than making honey, and that is pollination. That's right. The honeybee was designated the official insect of the state of Georgia in 1975. This is because of the honeybee's contribution to the state's economy and agricultural industry through the pollination of more than 50 Georgia food crops. Honeybees in the economy. Naturally, honeybees are nationally, honeybees are responsible for, in 2010, $215 million in honey and $15 billion in their pollination. In Georgia alone, honeybees are responsible for adding about $60 million annually to the economy. Honeybees in agriculture. Honeybees are responsible for pollinating 80% of the fruits and vegetables we eat. That's 80% of the insect pollinated fruits and vegetables that we eat. Pollination. Honeybee pollination is responsible for producing many planted vegetables and flower seeds. Home gardeners realize that the honeybees are necessary to their gardens. Honeybees pollinate, again, more than 50 Georgia food crops. Without the honeybees, fruit trees would bear fewer, smaller fruits, and berries would be smaller and misshapen. Vine crops like melons, cucumbers, squash, and pumpkins would bear smaller and less developed fruit. Because of the reduction in the size of other insect pollinators, the honeybees play a larger role in reseeding the wild plants. These plants serve as a source of fruits, nuts, vegetation for the consumption by various birds and mammals. Compared to other stinging insects, honeybees are docile, non-aggressive, and they are strict vegetarians. Yellow jackets, hornets, and wasps are carnivorous and therefore less aggressive. Interesting picture here shows a member of our bee club showing the inside of a bee colony to a young man who's never seen or touched a honeybee before, and you can see that they're both in the presence of thousands of honeybees unprotected. So honeybees are very mild. What attracts stinging insects? Carnivorous yellow jackets, hornets are attracted to garbage, picnic sites, and human food, but honeybees are attracted only to blooming plants. The backyard. Our beekeepers play a very important role in maintaining a healthy honeybee population, therefore play an important role in helping maintain a healthy environment. Beekeeping takes place everywhere. This is a picture of a bee colony at the White House. Likewise, at the Georgia Governor's Mansion in Buckhead, First Lady Sandra Deal shows two homes of the state's official insect. That is, she is standing between two honeybee colonies. Each of those colonies may have 40,000 or so bees in it. She's standing right between them. Metro Atlanta Beekeepers Association meet every month at the Atlanta Botanical Gardens. Honeybees away from the hives are not aggressive, and they're only focused on the collection of water or nectar and pollen from blooming plants. Honeybees won't sting even while they're in the hive if they don't perceive that the hive is being threatened. Again, a picture of one of our club members with the inside of a hive actually picking up a honeybee and handing it to a young person there. Honeybees will defend their hive only if provoked. Logical selection. It is to the beekeeper's advantage to ensure his hives are filled with gentle, non-aggressive honeybees. Experienced beekeepers easily manage honeybees with no protective clothing or equipment. How can we safely show unprotected children our honeybee yards? As you can see, this young lady has a honeybee on her face. Honeybees are not aggressive. They will sting only if they sense their hive is under attack, and this bee is obviously not sensing that his hive is in danger. Conservation of energy. Honeybees are very efficient. They rest anytime they are not working, so honeybees do not waste energy. Thus, the term beeline means a straight line. Because of this conservation of energy concept, honeybees fly the shortest distance between two points. They make a beeline. Unless you're in this beeline, you'll not encounter the bee, and if you do, she'll probably be above your head. When a honeybee is flying, she is consuming energy, and of course, their primary source of instant energy is honey. So if they're moving around when they shouldn't be, they're using up honey. If a honeybee is not actively foraging for food, she is patiently waiting in the hive, conserving energy. This is an example, this picture is an example of a beekeeper using good beekeeping practices. He is providing a water source close to the beehive so that the bees don't have to go far away to get water. Again, conserving energy. Backyard beekeepers rarely have more than two hives, and they're never unsightly. A Forsyth Beekeepers Club had honeybee observation hives in two Forsyth County schools. The Coal Mountain and the Chesty Elementary School had observation hives inside. Several other schools have requested hives from us to display in their schools. For years, we have maintained an observation hive at the Forsyth County Sunny Mountain Preserve Visitor Center. Again, it's inside the center so that easily seen by everybody that walks by, and I trust everybody's seen it, right? Yes. The hive's exit entrance, this again is the Sony Mountain Center, is located near the walkway to the mountain. You can see the paved path in front of it. The beehive is actually located in that L corner of the building, and because of its proximity to the path, there have been no stinging incidents. Forsyth Beekeepers Club was established in the 1990s. The club's bylaws state that our purpose, we shall cooperate with the county extension services as well as other beekeeping organizations to help promote the public awareness and the benefits and necessity of the honeybee. Now, how do we as a club do this? Annually, we conduct an open to the public honeybee school. Annually, we maintain a booth at the Forsyth County Fair where we teach fairgoers everything they need to know about honeybees. The club averages over 10 educational presentations at county schools every year. Additionally, we give guided tours of our apiaries to school groups, scouts, and anyone that asks. You can note in this picture is at one of our apiaries where hundreds of thousands of honeybees are, and you can see all the students there and people are in this yard without protection. So again, honeybees are mild. In Forsyth County in 2011, the Extension Service called us numerous times to assist county citizens with their concerns about bees in their yards. Extension Office also referred citizens to us to rescue honeybee colonies that were in bad locations. This is a picture of a front door of a house that's in the Hamptons. They had honeybees in the decorative woodwork above the front door. Now, if they called an exterminator, what would the exterminator have done? He'd have come and sprayed them. That way, the house would still have had a bunch of dead bees, as well as the honey and the rest of the comb. If he called us, and we would do it for free, the exterminator would probably charge money. We would remove not only the bees, but we would remove the hive, the honey. We would give them their same home in a different location. So we would remove all the insects from the house when we're called. And again, the Extension Office calls us, they called us in 2011 about 9 times to rescue some honeybees from people. When invited, we do presentations for local groups and garden clubs. The club's concerns for the public, and I'm sure they're the same as the concerns the commissioners have. We are concerned about honeybees and public health, public welfare, and public safety. Honeybees and public health. Honey is a natural antiseptic. Honey may fight local allergies. Apitherapy is the medical use of honeybee products, and those honeybee products are honey, pollen, bee bread, propolis, royal jelly, and bee venom. The honey, of course, is the bee's primary source of instant energy. People can use it to also for energy and for sore throats. Pollen, the bee's primary source of food and protein. People use pollen for energy, stomach and nervous system problems, and Alzheimer's treatments. Bee bread is a fermented mixture of honey and pollen. It may boost a person's health and athletic performance. Propolis is a resin-like material from trees that honeybees can use as construction glue. For people, it may strengthen their immune systems and stimulate a healthy heart. Royal jelly is a secretion the bees use for nutrition of larvae and the queen. For people, it may help fight anxieties and ulcers. Bee venom. Bee venom, of course, is a bee's defense mechanism. It is a protein mixture causing inflammation. For people, this bee venom can be used as an anticoagulant and is often used to help fight arthritis. Bees and the public welfare. This is a very important concept here. Honeybees pollinate over 50 food crops in Jordan, 80% of the fruits and vegetables we eat. So that literally one in every three bites of food you eat is from a plant that has been pollinated by a honeybee. So honeybees are very important to public welfare. Honeybee and public safety. United States Department of Agriculture says that one or two people out of 1,000 are allergic to the stings of bees. That means that 99.8% of bee stings to people are merely a nuisance. Being vegetarian, honeybees are attracted only to blooming plants. Unlike other flying insects, honeybees only sting in defense of their home. Therefore, rarely is a bee sting from a honeybee. If a bee does sting, the itching, swelling, and skin discoloration that some people report as an allergic reaction is actually a very common reaction and a sign of a good immune system. To review what we've covered about honeybees, the honeybee, they're very docile, they're vegetarian, and they will not sting unless provoked. Despite making honey, the most important thing the honeybees do is pollinate. Because of its importance to agriculture and the environment, the honeybee was designated the state of Georgia's official insect. Honeybee colonies have been steadily declining due to this thing called a colony collapse disorder. Because the honeybee does so much for us in the way of pollination and stuff, we need to do something for them. This can be accomplished by minimizing the restrictions on beekeepers. Local honey is recommended to combat allergies. The honeybees managed by backyard beekeepers help maintain a balanced ecological system. University of Georgia says that beekeepers are Georgia's best defense against Africanized bees. That's that part of the presentation. Now I'd like to review some of the nearby UDC codes. And to start with the ordinances for the state of Georgia, the Georgia State Code says that no county shall restrict the establishment or maintenance of honeybees in hives. But as you know, it does kind of contradict itself too, because in the very next sentence it says, this code shall not restrict the zoning authority of county governments. So essentially what they're saying here is that we are all encouraged to help honeybees, not restrict them. However, it says that without taking away your authority to make the appropriate regulations. This is a map of the state of Georgia. Every yellow circle you see is a beekeeper association club like ours. Every county that you see that's in white in this map has honeybees. Every county that you see that is in white in this map has beekeepers. Just not all of them belong to clubs. There are beekeepers in every county in the state of Georgia. Not every beekeeper belongs to a club. One third of Georgia bee clubs are in the Atlanta metropolitan area. Beekeepers clubs in our area, of course, one in this county, Cherokee, Bartow, Gwinnett, Henry, And of course, the Metropolitan Atlanta Beekeeper Association includes the counties of Fulton, Cobb, and DeKalb. The Hall County UDC, agriculture is allowed in all residential and even heavy industrial zones. Johns Creek UDC says that John Creek allows agricultural in all residential zones. The Alpharetta UDC allows agriculture in the listed zones. Gwinnett County UDC allows it in the listed zones. Our interpretation of the Forsyth County UDC section of definitions has agriculture as the commercial, emphasis on the word commercial there, commercial cultivation or growth from land of plant, dairy, livestock, poultry, and apiarian products, that's us. Since we emphasize the word commercial, it defines the word commercial as the use of any land for benefit to the general public for a fee. For backyard beekeepers, there are no fee products, or no products for the fees, and for the beekeeper, he does not get paid if his bees pollinate the crops of nearby farms. Therefore, backyard beekeeping does not fit the definition of commercial, therefore it doesn't fit the definition of agriculture. Forsyth County, an interesting comparison is that if home gardener takes their excess fruits and vegetables to sell at the farmer's market, does this make their home property commercial? We think we have shown the importance of honeybees, not just to our club, but also because of what the bee does for the environment and food crops. Honeybees impact the economy, public welfare, and the environment. There is a new green movement which leans toward helping rather than restricting all things natural like honeybees. Forsyth County, there are many similarities between backyard beekeeping, backyard gardening. All backyard beekeepers also have gardens, and backyard gardening has no regulations. Therefore, we believe that backyard beekeeping deserves no regulations. Forsyth County UDC tables 11A and 11B shows that non-commercial gardens are allowed in all residential zones. These tables should show the same restrictions for backyard beekeeping. That's my presentation, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
I have a couple comments and questions, if you mind, sir. Just a couple questions, please. And I'm going to be like a honeybee, not aggressive. This is just for me to clarify a couple of things, if you don't mind, please. And just know that I do have a garden, and I noticed a huge difference in it when one of my neighbors had honeybees for a little while. I don't know what happened to him. He said he didn't either. It just disappeared about 2 years ago. His big concern, he said, although he kept water nearby, but because he was the closest house to our pool, his big concern was that the bees may get into the pool with all the kids playing and such like that. And he told me that should that have happened, he would have taken the responsible move and moved his bees. It didn't happen, but I sure wish he had his bees back. That being said, does your club have any kind of a code or ethics code, or just simple rules like that they would follow that we wouldn't be here today if something would follow?
Again, every beekeeper does not belong to a club, so in some respects it does not matter what regulations we have in the club because they're not going to be enforced for all the beekeepers in the county.
Sure. I guess if you had, I wonder if it would help some just to keep...
That's a very important mission of our purpose of our club is to educate the public, and one of the things we've just incorporated into our annual bee school, which is going to be in February, is that we're going to now teach people the best management practices for keeping bees.
Thank you. And then the other...
Can I answer some of that?
Sure.
My name is Bill Dunn with Forsyth County Beekeeper. You mentioned your neighbor had bees.
Yes.
And he lost them. Probably one of the reasons he lost them is he wasn't taking care of the property. A lot of times, if you worry about the watering the bees, beekeeper will actually take and put out watering troughs or watering stations for the bees to actually start using to get the water. The more the bee travels, the more energy she uses. So if she has to only travel 50 yards or 50 feet to get all the water she needs, because she's going to go to that. And once they're attracted to, or trained to go to one area, that's where they'll go. They won't go any other places.
Thank you. The other thing is, no matter what the decision of this board is and how we handle it or not, I want you to know that an HOA can act separate from the county. They can set forth their own rules that may govern whether or not you can have them within their neighborhood, if they already have them within their HOA rules and policies.
Okay.
And that's it for me. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Sir, one question I have. Do you feel that bees should be allowed in every zoning district?
Yes, I do.
Could you address the size of the hive or two?
How many?
How many bees typically in a hive, and then how many hives do you think is appropriate?
Again, this is an issue where, for instance, the city of Memphis has no restrictions on number of hives. The honeybees will naturally determine the number of bees that a certain amount of land area can handle. So restricting the number of hives is not only not necessary, but it's will create an indication that you're not doing every, you know, we feel like we're not doing everything we can to help the honeybees continue to survive.
So in other words, if there were five white box hives and there wasn't enough flowers in
right.
the area, blooming plants in the area,
leave.
Then we wouldn't
the
necessarily have five full boxes.
Yep.
I would, board would like, I'd like to make a motion that honeybees be excluded from the definition of livestock and that beekeeping be allowed in all zoning districts in Forsyth County. Keeping in mind that HOAs and POAs and things of that nature can restrict it according to their bylaws, state and local laws, whatever they're set up for, that we can't override homeowners associations. But again, I'd make a motion that honeybees be excluded from the definition of livestock and the beekeeping be allowed in all zoning districts.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion?
Just to clarify, that just assuming within Commissioner Bell's motion that that's direction to staff to come back and begin the legal hearing process.
Whatever the staff feels is appropriate to carry this out, I would hope that we would
just going to leave all the beekeepers alone until we get it done. Well, we've got a motion in effect for that now to get it settled.
Okay, good.
Just going to leave alone to get it settled.
Okay. I'm simply clarifying so no one walks away from here thinking our code has changed this afternoon.
Yes, out of public hearing.
That's all. That's all.
We have a motion and a second. I guess the lights aren't on. Do they work?
No.
We have a motion and a second, and if you will, please vote on the motion. That passes unanimously. This process of the change in the UDC is going to take about a month, or maybe two. It takes a while, but you know that that's what's going to be changed. Did we pass a resolution to not do anything about beekeepers?
We just have a motion that's passed by the board to allow status quo until this is resolved.
So you're not in any kind of, shouldn't be any kind of danger of somebody coming and saying you got to move that beehive until it does get changed.
If an HOA has a problem, that's between the beekeeper and their owners. So.
Okay. With that, I guess we will go back into the smaller room and continue this meeting.
Mr. Chairman, can we just get just wait for a second and see who leaves, just to make sure we don't go back there and everybody follows back. I don't do that either.
You're welcome to stay.
You're absolutely welcome to stay.
And if you don't want to stay right here for the rest of the time, stay.
Thank you.
happy with the number? Yeah, this looks like a normal work session number, so if we want to convene, that's fine.
Okay. Thank you. Everybody will go back to the other room. Thanks.
I